In this section, we're going to take a look at the legal agreements for IAEA safeguards. Safeguards agreements can be concluded between the IAEA and a single state, or even groups of states. And there may also be a regional inspectorate involved with these agreements. If the safeguards agreement is with a group of states, there may be an independent or collaborative regional inspectorate that would be involved in the safeguards agreements. The safeguards agreements can be required from several different perspectives. One perspective is a nuclear supply agreement with another state, and that would be when one state wants to purchase nuclear technology from another state. The seller state, as a condition of the sale, would require that safeguards be applied to the state that is purchasing the nuclear technology. Also, treaty obligations. We discussed previously that the NPT and the Nuclear Weapons Free Zone treaties require their member states to conclude safeguards agreements with the IAEA. And also self-imposition. A state could want to prove that it does not have a clandestine nuclear weapons program or is diverting materials for the purpose of nuclear weapons. So they invite the IAEA to safeguard a facility and conclude an agreement based on that concept. And these agreements can come in various types. The first being IMCIRC 66, and this arrangement was developed prior to the NPT, and it's facility and material specific. So if we take a look here, we have our fictional sovereign state, and it has two nuclear facilities. With an IMCIRC 66 type safeguards agreement, safeguards could be applied to one facility, but not necessarily the other. This agreement would only allow the IAEA access to the materials that are in this one facility and the activities that occur at this one facility, and not necessarily the other one. The next type of agreement is IMCIRC 153. And this comes after the negotiation of the NPT. And this includes comprehensive safeguards agreements, or CSAs. And those cover all facilities and materials within a non-nuclear weapons state party to the NPT. So if we look back at our fictional sovereign state here, if it has IMCIRC 153 safeguards agreements, then both these nuclear facilities are going to be included in the state's safeguards agreements with the IAEA. IMCIRC 153 also includes voluntary offer agreements, and these are specific to nuclear weapon states. So those states that are codified as having nuclear weapons according to the NPT, they can conclude facility-specific safeguards agreements. They are in the style of the comprehensive safeguards agreements that non-nuclear weapon states have with the IAEA, but they're not to all the nuclear materials and nuclear facilities within the state. It's just the nuclear weapon state volunteers a specific facility with specific materials and gives the IAEA specific access that it negotiates. Then we also have the IMCIRC 540 and additional protocols. And this is more directed at undeclared proliferation activity. The IMCIRC 153 and IMCIRC 66 safeguards agreements are applied to declared facilities with declared materials. IMCIRC 540 and the additional protocols gives the IAEA power to look at the rest of the state in general and allows for environmental sampling, multi-entry visas for inspectors, and overall just increased access. So if there is, say, some undeclared facility in our fictional state here, then the IAEA has some capability to detect this activity going on in the state as a whole. So another concept we want to discuss is integrated safeguards. Integrated safeguards is the optimum combination of all safeguards measures available under comprehensive safeguards agreements and additional protocols. And this is integrated safeguards are applied to achieve maximum effectiveness and efficiency in the meeting of IAEA safeguards obligations within the available resources. So the integrated safeguards concept is more efficient than kind of a maximal level of all safeguards at all times. However, it is implemented in a state only when the IAEA has drawn a conclusion of the absence of undeclared nuclear material and activities. So in the beginning, the IAEA may take approach where it applies just maximal safeguards at maximum levels. However, once the absence of undeclared nuclear materials and activities can be verified and can be concluded, then it may be possible to shift to more of an integrated safeguards approach, which optimizes and streamlines things for effectiveness and efficiency. Under integrated safeguards, measures may be applied at reduced levels at certain facilities in some cases. Another concept that needs to be discussed is noncompliance. And this refers to a violation by state of its safeguards agreements with the IAEA. So some examples of issues of noncompliance are the diversion of nuclear material from declared nuclear activities. If this occurs, then a state may be found in noncompliance with its safeguards agreements. Another example could be failure to declare nuclear material required to be placed under safeguards. If additional nuclear material is found that was never declared, then the IAEA may find the state in noncompliance. If a state has an additional protocol, the failure to declare nuclear material, nuclear activities, or nuclear-related activities would be a cause for noncompliance. Violation of agreed recording and reporting system, any obstruction of the activities of IAEA inspectors could be a cause for a noncompliance conclusion, or interference with the operation of safeguards equipment could also be a grounds for finding a state in noncompliance. If a state is found in noncompliance, the IAEA Director General shall report the noncompliance to the IAEA Board of Governors, which would then call upon the recipient state to remedy any noncompliance that has been found. There are two general types of noncompliance, the first being the diversion of nuclear material. This could be undeclared removal of declared material. It could also be the use of a safeguarded facility for the introduction, production, or processing of undeclared nuclear materials. The other general form of noncompliance is misuse of a facility. And this could be the use of non-nuclear material, services, equipment, facilities, or information specified and placed under safeguards to further any prescribed purpose or proliferation activity. There can also be cases of exemption from IAEA safeguards. A state may request exemption of nuclear material up to certain specified limits if the state has a very low amount of nuclear material within it, then it may request and be approved for exemption from nuclear safeguards. A state may also request exemption for specific nuclear material that is related to a specific intended use. This could be gram quantities that are used as a sensing component within nuclear detection equipment and instruments. Or it could be plutonium that has an isotopic concentration of plutonium-238 exceeding 80%. This high concentration of plutonium-238 makes plutonium less desirable for nuclear weapons. So in that case, the IAEA may grant an exemption of safeguards. If the exempted material, nuclear material, is to be processed or stored together with safeguarded material, then safeguards have to be reapplied. So if there's specific material, perhaps that is used with a radiation detector for sensing as part of the detector, then it is taken out of safeguards and used with that detector. But if it's ever reintroduced to an area or stored together with safeguarded material, then it has to be accounted, declared, and accounted for in accordance with the original safeguards. One final concept that we want to discuss here is the state system of accounting and control for nuclear material. Under a comprehensive safeguards agreement, the state is required to establish and maintain a state system of accounting and control, or SSAC. And the SSAC basically deals with the nuclear material accountancy of all the materials within a state and needs to be maintained with the IAEA.